And you know, I get excited when the interviews go, but this is a really interesting show. And based on the repartee that was going on between Garry Pastore and P.j. Bracco and Terry Jean Vitale before we went on air, this is good stuff. So before we plunge into this, I have to do the obligatory station ID. You are listening to NJ Discover Radio. To find out more, go to njdiscover.com or follow us on Facebook, NJ Discover Production Page. You can also follow us on Twitter at NJ Discover, and that's the station ID. And this is one of my favorite times of the show when it gives me huge pleasure to introduce my vivacious, bubbly, effervescent, wonderful co-host, Tara Jean Vitale.
Thank you. Thank you so much. Thank you, everybody, for tuning in. And, of course, I want to introduce the most wonderful radio host ever. It's Calvin Schwartz, my dear friend, who I actually got a little nervous today. Made him freak out a little bit on the way in here.
You did.
Because I was running a little late.
What is it in my personality? Seriously. And maybe I need to go to Dr. Melfi, who we were just talking about.
Yeah, maybe.
What is it in my personality that makes people do these kind of things?
Well, you call me and I'm like 1 minute late, and I knew it once I saw you calling that you thought I had overslept because I took a little nap today.
Yes, yes.
And so as I'm walking down the studio stairs, I'm answering the phone. I'm saying, "Wait, Calvin, oh my God, what time is it? I just woke up," and you were freaking out.
Yeah, I was freaking out. I was very, very nervous. And then there you were,
and
standing
there
in the hallway.
I was standing there.
So, but you know, listen,
that's good, Calvin.
I'm not a vengeful person.
Oh, you aren't?
No, no.
Thank goodness.
But it'll be returned one day. So, we have our little thing that we do, mm-hmm. and it's like, what did you do over the weekend?
Yes, and we had a long time between the last show. So, but the one thing I'm really excited about is NJ Discover's working on a new TV series. On the Avenue, and we were actually in Hoboken last weekend with the whole production team, NJ Discover, shooting at Crank in Hoboken. It's this incredible workout, nutritional, inspirational place, and so we did a shoot there, and that was, I'm really excited about that. And this weekend, we're actually going to be in Freehold shooting at Descondido, and they have a guacamole station and tequila flight. I learned all about tequila today. It was really nice. And hopefully I'll get to taste some of that at the shoot.
Cool.
After the shoot.
Very cool.
But then the other things I did was I went to see Joe Bonanno and the Godsons, and mm-hmm. you accompanied me to that.
I did.
That was at Park 33?
Park 33 in Freehold.
And then we, and then of course I saw Grease at Red Bank Catholic High School because my daughter's in that. She's Cha-Cha. So I got to see Grease, which was really fun. Danny's like, "Go and Sandy and go Grease Lightning."
Oh, that's cool.
Grease Lightning. Yeah, it was fun. So what about you, Calvin? What did you do? You've been very busy.
I've been very busy. And but I have a, first of all, we got to do a shout out. We do a couple of shout outs.
Okay.
We have a shout out to, this is important, to our very, very good friend, Mike Marino, New Jersey's Bird Boy of Comedy.
Mm-hmm.
Mike is going to be here in New Jersey on Saturday, May 17th at 8 p.m. at the Union County Performing Arts Center in Rahway, New Jersey, www.ucpac.org. And we've seen Mike a dozen times.
So funny.
He is so
like
funny.
Like tears down your eyes funny.
Just an amazing, amazing, amazing comedian. So that's one shout out. Another shout out is to my cousin, his book, A Wit's World, which is a compilation of six stories, is actually getting some very good reviews on Amazon. So check it out, folks. It's under Stuart, S-T-U-A-R-T, books, all one word, .com, and bravo to my cousin, Stuart.
Yeah,
now,
Stuart.
Should I do? So I know Garry and P.j. are having...
They're being very, very quiet.
Very
which is
quiet.
Shocking, actually.
I do see some smiles, and this is a happy, upbeat, but I have a segment that I want to do just before we get really exuberant and have fun. I have a serious segment.
And can we all respond to this?
Well, you can. It's not for response. It's not for.
You're just going to lay it on the table?
I'm just going to lay it on the table.
For us to think about?
Yes, this is strictly for thinking. It's a very provocative.
Okay, it's a thinking moment.
These are. It's very provocative.
Is this where we sing Kumbaya?
Oh. By the way, that's no. I can't believe you said that.
My Lord,
it's one of my favorite songs.
Kumbaya, kumbaya, my Lord, kumbaya.
This is really actually. I'm going
to
call.
Brings me back to my days of Hare Krishnas.
Yeah. In your honor, this is going to be henceforth the Kumbaya segment. And what it is, it's we have to be serious too sometimes, right?
Okay,
absolutely.
Okay. We can do that.
So these are things.
Sit up straight.
And this is heavy stuff. Yeah, you know, heavy stuff. These are things that scare the hell out of me. Okay, and I only just give you the topic, and that's it. I mean, I don't
elaborate.
I don't elaborate. Thank you.
Thank you.
No elaboration. I just throw these things out for you folks out there in TV land to ponder and to think about.
Radio land.
So what scares the hell out of me? And I am totally apolitical. I have no political ambitions. I'm not running for anything. These are things that I observe in our world that scare me and bother me.
Mm-hmm.
The first, George Zimmerman, that guy who we know he shot Trayvon Martin. He's been invited to sign autographs at gun shows. Moving on.
Awesome.
Beautiful.
Moving on.
God.
Yes.
God bless
America. Yes. Yeah. Isn't that kind of amazing? Okay, moving on. Mm. This really concerns me because I am a consumptive banana person.
Mm-hmm.
And we now have the merger of...
Wait.
Oh, no.
Does this mean that you eat a lot of bananas?
I do.
Oh, okay.
No, I do.
And are you going to...
And which way do you peel them?
By the way, there's an old, never mind.
I know that
joke. I know you don't.
Yeah, don't go there.
No, I'm not going there.
Even though this is radio.
I don't know.
Huh?
I don't know. I don't want to know.
Afterwards, we'll, Garry knows later.
Yeah.
Anyway, Chiquita.
Chiquita.
Chiquita merged with, and you'll like this, Chiquita merged with Fifes. It's the largest banana people in Ireland. And they have a new company that's going to control the distribution of 160 million boxes of bananas. Moving on. There has been no new malls built in America since 2006.
Are you paying attention there, Brigitte?
Huh?
No new mall. You're going to give this girl a coronary.
And by the way, it's very scary that really means.
Do we need new malls?
Oh, my gosh.
What does that mean? Oh, it's because it's internet.
Someday there won't be any malls.
That's because we're internet shopping.
Correct.
Oh, that's
what it means.
Exactly. And soon we'll have little helicopter things.
Drones. Delivering. Delivering.
Delivering.
I like that.
The wonton soup.
Yes. George Jetson.
Yes. Yes.
Oh, I love it.
Finally, and the last, in the segment, what did I do? Well, 2 weeks ago at this time, I was at Jersey Shore Hospital having a cardiac procedure.
Mm-hmm.
Mm-hmm.
And I'm going to do a lot of stuff about this. I've written some articles about it. And my advice prematurely is don't go to Jersey Shore Hospital and watch for my coverage of my 2 days in that hospital, which will appear on NJ Discover and hopefully throughout the country. End of segment. I'm looking at Garry. It gives me, and Tara Jean, a tremendous amount of pleasure to introduce Garry Pastore. You are just about everything in entertainment. You write, produce, direct, act. You even were a culinary person. So, Garry, welcome to the show. And why don't you just throw a little bit of a bio for everybody, if quickly, and take it.
Bio?
You know,
a
little
history.
Well, just a little history.
You can ask questions, and I'll give you answers.
Okay.
I'm not going to sit here. I was born where 500 years ago.
Well,
I got a mother and father.
Way back when I was
way back
a little
when
kid.
When I was dusty. No.
Well,
you ask a question. I'll give you an answer.
I'm going to ask a question. So,
right,
where are you from? How's about that?
I was born in Brooklyn, New York.
Yeah, Brooklyn.
In the 60s. I'm not giving the exact date because I don't have to.
No.
And that information is available online, by the way. So annoying. Why did I gotta put my
birthday? Well, as an actor, you're just a range anyway, so you're a range.
Exactly.
You're
not
a
number. How old are you? I don't know, 40 or 50. Pick one.
How old do you want me to be?
Yeah, exactly. How old do you want me to be? Middle child. There was four of us. Now I have four of my own. And, nice. You know, stickball. Stoop Paul, Skelly, Johnny on a Pony. We did it all when I was a kid.
You still in Brooklyn? No.
No.
You're in New Jersey?
I'm a Jersey boy.
Yeah, Jersey.
Well, I'm a Jersey boy now.
Everybody comes.
I grew up here, but hey, listen, go west, young man, and I did. I stopped in Staten Island for a brief period. I had a couple of cups of coffee there, and then I made it to Jersey. I started to get a little crowded, so it was time to leave. I'm in, hello, Staten Island, if you listen, but I'm happy here. I like New Jersey.
There's a lot of people from Staten Island that are in New Jersey now.
Oh, I know that, especially this neighborhood.
Yeah.
Marlboro?
Yeah.
Marlboro? Oh, yeah.
Big time.
This is the Staten Island Annex.
Mm-hmm.
It's completely that way. I'm a huge minority, and so are you.
Yeah, I am too.
But I'm a Newark boy.
Well, that's why I found most of the Jerseyites emigrated from is Newark,
Belleville.
Belleville, you know, up that neck of the woods, and then they kind of dispersed throughout the state. You know, it's very rare you meet somebody who's actually born and raised down in South Jersey, but I meet them every now and then.
Mm-hmm.
They usually never went into Manhattan. It's pretty funny.
Yeah, it is.
What's Manhattan? I've never been there. They have cars there. Buses, too.
We call
wow, trains.
We call it the city. Remember, we just called it the city.
Yeah, we went to
you
the
going
city.
To the city?
Yeah, going to the city? Oh, that's far.
What's the city? Jersey City.
You did mention to me in our chatting, you actually started out going to culinary school.
Yes, I did.
And what happened?
What happened? It was cool. I mean, you know, I didn't know what I was going to do after high school. I was in a rock band, and I cut my hair, and then I did West Side Story at the beckoning of my drama teacher, Sidney Schwartz. Stanley Schwartz. I'm sorry, Stanley. May you rest in peace. He came and saw my band play, and he asked me to play Tony in West Side Story, and I did. And I cut my hair, and I continued to play in rock bands, and I took about 6 months off before I went to college, and I decided to go to culinary school because I thought being a chef would be fun, and it was not. However, I did get out of school, and I worked at the Waldorf. And I remember I was living in Staten Island, and I worked late shift at the Waldorf, and I took the ferry back, and I fell asleep on the ferry and wound up back in Manhattan again. I said, you know what, this job sucks, and I quit. And then I moved to Manhattan, and I had like three jobs. I was modeling acting, and I worked in this place called the Silver Palette, which is pretty famous. It was a little eatery on Columbus Avenue in 71st Street or 72nd Street. And I worked there for a while, and I remember one day the owner came over and said, I got a party tonight, and I don't know who to send because it's a high clientele, high celebrity clientele. And, you know, you're in film business, and I don't think that you get probably too crazy with meet celebrities, but a lot of the people that have gone don't know how to act. So I go to this apartment on Fifth Avenue by the park, and I get patted down, and there's Secret Service, and I'm like, who the frig am I cooking for, you know? I go in, it was Jackie Onassis. So I wound up doing this party, and I cooked all the appetizers and whatnot. Jackie was there, and this was the best. I'm in the oven pulling these little pizzas out that I made, and I hear this voice behind me, pizzas are delicious. And I turn around, and it's James Bond.
Oh,
it was Sean Connery.
Wow.
I was like, holy crap. I said, please just say for me one time, where's Pusha? And he did. He goes, okay, where's Pusha now? Give me my pizza. But anyway, yeah, that was... It was great. It was great. It was a great experience. I wound up working for her for like 2 years. And I kind of got out of the restaurant business. I meandered my way out. I didn't like being in a hot kitchen. But now I cook. I cook for my wife. I cook for my kids. I cook for, I entertain. People want to come over. I have this open door policy. You're allowed to come in and eat, but bring wine. But yeah, you know, I do the holidays and stuff. But it was great. I got bored with it. And, you know, just I kept doing the acting thing. And it's unfortunate. I wrote a cookbook in 1996 for college kids. My nephew was going to Ohio State. He played football. And he said, you know what? He goes, Unc, he goes, give me something that I could cook for the guys after football. I said, no, make this. He goes, why don't you make a cookbook for college kids? So I did it.
What's the name of it?
You're Not in Mom's Kitchen Anymore. That's awesome. I don't even know if you can buy it anymore. I was going to revamp it and come out with another edition.
Yeah.
But,
that's a nice idea.
Yeah, it was cool. You know, it had recipes for college kids and quick and easy stuff. It was fun. You know, we tried to make it comical. And
so what was the first big break in your acting career? When was that?
I've had so many breaks, you know. It's weird because I was on a soap opera as a recurring role. And I went in one day. Then I'm reading the copy, and I'm not going to mention the soap opera because I don't think it would be fair to them, but I'm reading the copy, and I was like, to one of the other actors, I said, who writes this? This sucks. And I was wired and mic'd.
Oh, no.
And they heard it. Yeah, and I lasted about one more episode. So wow. I had a break, and then I got broke.
That was, I remember that lesson in college. Don't comment on the writing.
Don't comment on the writing.
Just read it.
Mm-hmm.
Well, I couldn't help it. It was horrible. I couldn't get through it. But, yeah. And so it was a blessing in disguise. You know, it's been that kind of life. Where I was in Goodfellas for 2 weeks. I worked on it with Martin Scorsese, thinking I'm going to be in the movie, and the movie comes out, and I'm cut out.
Hmm.
And it kind of perturbs you because it's one of the bigger films. You know, I'm in it. You see me, I got a credit, but it's hard. Acting is very, very, very hard. It's a lot of perseverance. There's a lot of, you know, just to even get in a door to get an audition is tough. And you get in the door and you're in auditioning and you're in a room with 20 other guys that look just like you.
Mm-hmm.
And, or maybe they don't want somebody that looks like you. Maybe they want somebody that's shorter or taller or fatter or skinnier or lighter or darker. You don't know what goes through their mind. All I know and I've learned from acting is, I guess, just being in the right place at the right time, having the right script, giving the right delivery, trying to remember your lines, not be nervous. I mean, there's so many variables that go into it, and I can't think that one day is better than the next. I've gone in and thought I've nailed auditions, never get a call.
Right.
I've gone home and said I screwed that up, I get a call. So I don't think about it anymore. I don't, you know, all I know is I've always had a job, because you have to have a job if you're an actor.
Yeah.
Otherwise, you'll be a homeless actor. That's the sad part about it, is, you know, these people get these wide-eyed dreams that they're going to get off that bus from Ohio, and their life's going to change, and it's full of disillusionment, you know. I think the problem that I see most of all with acting, and you can agree with me, PJ, is that people get into the business because they don't know what else to do with their lives.
Yeah.
They say, oh, that guy on TV, I could do that. That's easy.
Well, they want to be famous.
Or they want to be famous, right. Which is the worst, worst reason to get into become an actor, because 99.9% of the time you will not become famous.
Mm-hmm.
You know, you got a better chance of getting hit by a plane. Well, maybe not. They can't even find the plane. sorry, but you know. But yeah, you know, it's a very convoluted, difficult line of work.
It's a horrible roller coaster.
And is that why you kind of pulled away from that and started going into?
No, I just always felt that I have to make a living.
Okay.
You know, and whatever it is, whether you're single, married, whatever, you have to bring home a paycheck. You have to pay bills. And as everybody knows, it's harder and harder these days to pay bills. So, you know, even when I do have a good run at something, you know, it lasts for a little while and it goes. And the smart people save their money.
Can we get a little listing for the audience of shows, of movies that you've been in that people would recognize? Yeah, just ramble. Just do a handful so people, if they haven't known about what you've done before, they can get an idea of who they're listening to.
Britzy's Honor was one of my first films. Cocktail with Tom Cruise. In fact, that's when I first met him. Do the Right Thing, which Danny Aiello actually... I used to work at a restaurant back during this time period, right after I stopped cooking. And I was like a host at this restaurant called Columbus, which was very, very famous. It was like a Spago of New York City. Mm-hmm. And everybody came there. And I was like the host slash bouncer slash whatever, you know. I kind of got you a table. I got you in the place, which was very hard to get in. But the first person they saw, ask Danny for anything, even though I was an aspiring actor. And I see a lot of actors make that mistake that they'll go over to an actor and go, hey, I'm an actor. And they'll go, okay, goodbye. Yeah. You know, but I never said anything. And, you know, Danny kind of just said, hey, listen, I got something for you. And he put me in Do the Right Thing. And it was one of my first breakout roles. And I remember I was on 2020. My clip was at the Academy Awards, actually. So yeah, I was there watching the Academy Awards, and my clip was on. My mom was still alive, and that was great. You know, that my mom got to see that. I wish she got to see things now as they start to progress. So yeah, that, and then Goodfellas, and Donnie Brasco. Every cop or gangster movie in the last 20 years.
Yeah, and you're in either the bad guy or the good guy. Which one more? I would say more than what, the bad guy.
That's about even.
Yeah.
That's about even. But please. Usually the bad guy. Usually, I don't know why. I have this great face for radio. I don't know why that I would be picked as you know.
I see you, though, as a police officer type, too, though.
Yes, I do that a lot.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. All right.
We should remind our listeners that we're doing this special show tonight with Garry and PJ because they're filmmakers. Mm-hmm. And both have films that are going to be represented in the Garden State Film Festival, which is going to be April 3rd through April 6th mm-hmm. in Atlantic City. And I believe both Garry's a film, Destressed, and PJ's film, Going Down, will both be shown on Saturday, April 5th.
Yes.
So, Garry, let's talk a little bit about Destressed. How did this movie come about? And it's kind of a documentary. There's a lot of truth to this movie. How does that come about? And what is your creative process? What are the emotions that we're fomenting? I just threw a nice word. I looked it up before I came here.
Fomenting.
Fomenting.
Okay. I like that word. That's a good word.
Okay, good.
Well, festering. Okay. Festering. Fomenting. Okay.
So talk about Destressed.
Okay. It came about. I was stressed out. It was just everything. Work, family, wife, children, that constant get up every day, knowing I have to go up and go to work, you know, pay the bills. The career, balancing the career, trying to get the acting career going again, knowing about work and, you know, kids. It was just a confluence of good and bad. And stress, unfortunately, is one of those things that just affects everybody and affects everybody differently. It affected me that I kept it internal, and I got a intestinal disease called diverticulitis, which many of you must know about.
Mm-hmm.
It's an intestinal inflammation, which can get very, very serious if it's not taken care of, either by meds or by diet. And since I am one of those people that refuses to go to doctors, or at least I did, and refused to take care of myself and eat right, I was the perfect candidate to get struck down with this. And boy, did I get struck down. I went into work. I was doing a pilot. One of the things that I haven't explored yet is that I am a member of Local 52, which is the union that does grips and props and I'm sorry, guys, that's Local 600. Grips and props and electricians and other departments in the film business. And I did that to pay the bills. You know, I still worked in the film business. I worked behind a camera every day. And it was great for me because I got to work in the industry that I like and love. And I get to, every day is a new learning experience being behind the camera. But also I'm not doing the things that I want to do. So it has its good and bads. But I went into work. I was working on a pilot. And I didn't eat well. I was aggravated about something that was going on with a business that I had invested in. There was some kind of embezzlement going on. And I was pretty aggravated. Between that and the job, I grabbed a bag of trail mix. I ate it. And the little coconut husks got stuck into my intestine. Mm. And they perforated the intestine. So I didn't know, but I started getting septic.
Wow. Oh, my God.
So I went into work. I could barely walk. I was running 100 and something fever, 104, I think. And one of my friends told me, he says, "You look like crap." And I said, "Yeah, I don't feel good." And he goes, "Well, you better get to a doctor." And if I didn't get to the doctor, I'd not be here telling a story.
Wow.
Because I was sick. I was really, really sick. I was so sick that when I got to the doctor, they rushed me by ambulance to the hospital.
Wow.
So that guy did save my life that day. Thank you, Jimmy Mazzola. While I was in the hospital, I said, you know, this has got to stop. This whole everything, life, this constant moving 150 miles an hour, not eating right, not thinking right. I said, you know, I'm going to leave my kids fatherless. It's got to stop. And I got to do something about it. And I decided it was time to do a movie about it. Time to do a movie about stress. And not just my stress, but other people's stress. And I shot the first couple of months. Probably invested, I don't know, probably half of what I invested now. About $50,000, I guess, in the first couple of months. And ran out of money, and then we shut down. I always wanted to finish the film. I knew I had a good short film, but I didn't want a short film. I wanted a long film. The film, what this was about. The sense is that a lot of things happened in the 2 years since I shut down. I became a parent again. I became a father at 50 of a beautiful 2-year-old daughter named Lila, who was featured in the film. I obviously got better. We had the Sandy storm, which devastated our state and the people in it. I traveled across country, and I went through other damaging storms. I stopped in Moore, Oklahoma, talked to the people. A lot of lives lost, especially. And I met a lot of great people along the way that are less fortunate than I am. And I realized that when we, our lives aren't really that bad after all, compared to that helped me, I guess, heal and do my own healing. I feel that stress is one of those things that we can prevent if we all try to prevent it.
Mm-hmm.
But you have to want to prevent it.
Yeah.
You have to take the measure. One of the things I talk about in the film is the alarm clock. You hit your snooze alarm 3 times, and you're 30 minutes late. All day.
Entire day.
That's why
your entire day.
It's over.
You will hit traffic. Off. Mm-hmm. You'll go into work and have issues with people that you work with because you're upset because you pressed that alarm clock. I mean, this morons day out, day in, because I was that guy. And now instead of going in 30 minutes late, I go early. Guess what? I'm tired, but
I'm not
that stress ball that I was.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
So I'll deal with the tiredness. I'll try and get a cat nap in somewhere during the day, but I'm not going to go and want to punch some guy out that I run into on the road because he cut me off. And it did happen on the way over here today, actually.
Really?
Yeah. On the Guard State Parkway.
Was that you?
Yeah, hey, listen, if you were to jerk in the glass truck, we can go out and settle this now. Oh, that guy really got me annoyed. But, you know.
Now, was this scripted or was this kind of like a Woody Allen movie, right? Where they you just kind of improv it.
Was yeah, it was a lot of improv. Scripted was it was scripted in my brain. I would call it outlined.
Okay. Mm-hmm. Yeah.
All right. Because I can't say that. Then it's not a documentary. You can't really right, script yeah. a documentary.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
You could push it a little bit.
You could push it.
That's reality. It's different.
Yeah.
I think people that write documentaries, I think you're actually writing what you want to have in your film.
Well, I mean, you see the story. You see the story that you want to produce. Okay, I want to make a documentary out of that, and
you've got to let it flow. Kind
of, you do your research, and yeah, you kind of you do put a skeleton together.
Yeah, I think there's a misconception. I think documentaries are created. So it should be created by.
Right.
Instead of written by.
Okay.
Right.
I think it is written by online, which probably is not supposed to be, but it's a documentary anyway you look at it. I call it a docudramedy, actually. I think I've taken the documentary and I've turned it into something less boring. Sometimes you watch documentaries, they can be very boring.
Mm-hmm. This one's not boring at all.
I tried to make it as unboring as possible and thought-provoking. I want people to leave the movie and really get something from it. I really want this to be the pay-it-forward film that you watch it and you tell somebody, you got to go see this movie. You know why? Because it's good. It really will tell you to plan out your days better, to plan out your life better, and to stop bitching about things that you shouldn't bitch about.
Right.
I mean, you know, in life, we complain about everything. It's too hot. It's too cold. There's too much traffic. There's too much this. There's too much. You have no idea what life is like in other parts of the world, the country, that they would love to have you be you. Sit in traffic, be hot, be cold. These people sometimes don't have a bed to sleep in. You know, I met people from San Diego. They didn't have a home for 15, 16 months. Months. I couldn't picture one day being in their shoes. Not one.
And everything gone. All
everything
their
gone.
Personal life.
I mean, I was going crazy that night. I remember the water was dripping down out of my roof. It was coming from every place. I had 5-gallon buckets all over the place. I'm screaming. Ah! I got up the next day, and I went down the shore. My boat was in somebody's restaurant.
Wow.
It actually got up off the blocks, floated down the block, and went through the front of a restaurant.
That's crazy.
And that was my boat. That was my sanctuary. But you know what? I didn't lose my life.
Mm-hmm.
I didn't lose my house. I didn't lose any relatives, any friends. But I saw a lot of loss of life, friends, relatives, houses, people's, you know, their whole life. Those poor people in Union Beach. Oh my gosh.
Yeah.
Oh my gosh. And I look, I feel bad for the people in Manilokan, but that's your house. You have the money, you know, rebuild. These people, they worked. This is all they had. You know? And Staten Island, too, got hammered.
Oh, they got hammered.
Hammered.
Yeah, that was horribly sad. So it's really a perspective, then, on how you look at life that could help you de-stress and live a better life. But what's the main feeling that you want people to come away with? Do you want the people to watch this who are feeling stressed and know people who are stressed and that they're going to take away from this answers? Are they going to?
There's not one person that's even sitting in this room that does not deal with stress. I don't believe it.
It's true.
I do not believe it for 1 minute. And I say in the film, I'm not saying you're going to watch this movie, you're not going to be stressed out anymore, because that's a lie.
Okay.
You know, and if you think that that's going to happen, then you're delusional. You will still deal with stress, but it's how you deal with it that could be different. You know, during the Sandy thing, and after I lost my I'm sad, I'm upset. But I knew there were people that needed help. I filled up my car with water and paper towels and toilet paper and rags and stupid things that we take for granted. And I went and I gave them out to people.
Mm-hmm.
One guy knocked on his door. I wanted to put this in the film, but it didn't stay in the film. I knocked on his door. I handed him a case of water and paper towels. And he looked at me like I had three heads. He took it. He went in his house. He closed the door. I went, oh, thank you too. Aww. Bye. He opened up the door and he came out and he hugged me and started crying on my shoulder.
Oh.
He said, nobody came but you.
Changing changing quickly, and we're going to switch over to PJ. Just a couple of comments on Rob the Mob, this movie that you're in.
I got called last year to do this. I was doing Spider-Man, which I am. Spider-Man 2. I'm actually a stuntman in. I get into a gun battle with Electro, who's played by Jamie Foxx, and Spider-Man, and he get into this little tit-a-tat as well, and Spider-Man gets thrown at me by Jamie Foxx, and I kind of dive out of the way as this newsstand explodes in a million pieces. And I was working on that. We were working nights, and I got a call from my manager that I got an audition for this film, Rob the Mob. And then I'd be reading for Sammy the Bull Gravano, which was pretty intriguing. And I went in, and with the help of some of the guys, it was great. We were sitting in the cop car at night waiting to do our runs. We call them runs. Mm. And they were running lines with me in the police car. So until I got it off book. I had 9 pages of dialogue that I had to memorize. Wow. It was not easy.
Wow. No.
And these guys wouldn't let me out of the police car until I had every line down. Wow. And we worked the night before, and I was exhausted. I mean, we worked from 6 o'clock at night until 6 in the morning every morning. And I probably had about 4 hours sleep. And I kind of limped into the casting director's office, and I read, and I got the call like 2 days later. You nailed it. You got it. They're offering you Sammy. And I did it. I went to see the movie the other night. The film is great. It's from Ray DeFalletta. Falletta. He did Two Family House, and he did this great film called City Island. And the film stars Andy Garcia and Ray Romano. And
you.
And me.
Yes.
And Michael Rispoli, who's a friend of mine. Kudos to all those actors. Kudos to everybody that worked on it. It was awesome.
When can we see it?
It's out. It's out limited, and I think it opens wide in just about 2 weeks.
Excellent.
Yeah. It's just such a great story. It's so amazing, it's almost not real, but it is real.
Oh, it's a crazy story.
It's a crazy story. I can't wait to see it.
The film was very, very, very entertaining, very funny. Just before I go, I just want to thank everybody that has worked with me on my film, Destressed. Folke Barson, my partner, Deb Mello, Brigitte Lutz, my publicist. My crew, the actors that were able to work, the Eddie Testa band. The music for the film is awesome, which when you guys come see it, you'll see that the soundtrack kind of goes. And the cinematography is just absolutely spellbinding because it takes you from this journey that I go on in search of my zen. I start in New Jersey, I go to Florida, Vegas, get in the car, drive to Utah, I drive to Albuquerque, New Mexico, to meet some woman who was 107 years old.
Wow.
And I wanted to find out what her secret for zest in life was. Mm-hmm. And she's not in there long, but she was the sweetest little old lady I ever met in my life. I brought her a box of chocolates. It was about 9 billion degrees that day. And she was great. Just everybody that I met along the way in this film was outstanding. And I think if you can't take away something from this movie, you're not human.
It's a challenge.
Yeah, it's one of those films that you really got to be able to relate to in some way, shape, or form. It's either not, if it's not coming from you, it's coming from somebody else.
Hmm.
Okay.
And I'm excited because Calvin and I are in your film.
Yes, you both are.
Little cameo.
Nice. This thing that we shot up in Union County College.
It'll be the first time I'll see myself on a big screen like that.
Well, you're very photogenic, there, young lady.
Thank you very much.
You'll have a face other than radio. I don't want to take up
radio
PJ's
voices.
Time over
here. Yeah, let's see it to PJ.
Okay, segue.
How you doing?
Hello, PJ Bracco.
Hello, Cal.
How are you?
I'm doing okay. How you doing?
We met a year ago.
Yes, we did.
At the Gwent State Film Festival.
Yes.
And your dad, I met your dad at at the environmental thing in Long Branch, and I sat next to him, and we were talking, and we exchanged in business cards, and here you are.
Here I am.
And you have a movie going down. So, but
yes.
Before we jump into that, Garry didn't like the bio deal, but...
I don't like the bio deal either.
Okay, so... So
it's awkward. It's weird.
It's awkward and weird.
Yeah. All right, so... Yeah.
But he's from Brooklyn, too, isn't he?
Yeah, my family's from Brooklyn, Staten Island. Brooklyn.
What the
heck? Did you make it to Jersey yet?
Oh, no, yeah, no, we to Jersey.
How long are you here?
Originally moved out to Jersey in 85, 86, then to Boston, then back to Brooklyn.
Wow.
And lived there, and that's where I started my company, Red Hook Films. I moved to Red Hook with, at the time, she was my girlfriend from Maine, which was a horrible thing I did to her. She's from Maine. I moved her down to Brooklyn. our apartment.
Why, they have lobsters in Brooklyn.
Yeah.
Lobster. Then chatter.
Yeah. No, my apartment was on the BQE.
Oh, that sucks.
Wow.
Literally on the BQE. Yeah, but God bless her, love her dearly. She stayed with me. And after all these years, we're still married, which is wonderful. It's my buddy, but we moved to Red Hook, and that's where I started my company, Red Hook Films, neighborhood my great grandfather settled in, off the boat from Sicily many many moons ago, and had at it over there.
Mm-hmm. So you. You went to BU.
Yes, I went to Boston University.
And you studied theater.
I studied, yeah.
So you really knew you wanted to do this from an early age.
Yeah, absolutely, yes.
Okay.
I dabbled in other things. I mean, before wanting to be an actor, I was a photographer until I shot my first wedding.
Okay.
That must not be fun. We'll leave that there.
Yeah.
I wanted to be an actor. It was... there are many reasons why, but yes.
So all your energies have been put together, and this is going down. Is
going down is my
directorial debut.
Several things.
Okay.
I wrote it, I produced it, I directed it, I starred in it. I jumped off the cliff on this one.
Okay.
It took 3 years. To get off the ground from the writing of the 28 drafts, getting my friends together to do the readings and fixing this, fixing that, and raising the money. First investor came in, that led to another investor, and all of a sudden, there I was sitting at a table with a bunch of guys and nervous as hell and really didn't know what I was doing. I mean, it's as simple as that. We had, you know, I had a discussion earlier about what I would tell the kids that are going into college for filmmaking or acting. No, go to school for business.
Mm-hmm. Really,
get a degree in business. Know what you know what to do. Know
that comes
how
in handier than.
Because, you know what, the best acting lesson I ever got was from my father before I went to college. And he said to me, the one thing you should always remember is acting is it's what you do. You get up in the morning, you scratch your butt, you take a leak. You're not thinking about that. You're just doing it. Mm-hmm. That's acting. You just live it. Making movies is capturing how you see it and telling a good story. You need to know how to tell a good story.
Right.
But when it comes to the careers, it's business. It's developing relationships. It's knowing how to cross the T's, dot the I's. It's knowing how to read a contract. You know, and knowing how to negotiate. Mm-hmm.
Raise money.
Which sucks. When you raise money, knowing how to budget things and knowing that, these are the right numbers.
Right.
And things go wrong.
I've met two people. It's funny when you raise money. They're either the people that are like, they're really intrigued, and then you meet the ones that are really full of crap.
Yeah.
The ones that are full of crap just want to talk to you about the movie business.
Right.
They really have no interest in ever giving you a dime. The other ones are like, I don't know, would I really want to give you money or make a movie? You know?
Yeah.
And, you know, that's the two that you really deal with.
Mm-hmm.
And
sometimes
you meet. There's really no easy way to.
No, it's a bump and grind.
I mean,
it's
I have to say,
is it a numbers game where you speak to 100 people, you maybe have one response or?
It starts with the script.
Yeah.
I think you have to have a really, really good script. If you have a good script, that's your starting point.
Right.
And then from that, you go out and you try and find really, really good actors.
Well, that's...
To be in your really, really...
Yeah. Good, absolutely.
Really, really love your really, really good script. And then when you have that...
Do you have to do a promo first to sell it to your investors? Or like a little clip or...
You know...
A budget you need.
You need a budget. Here's my, in terms of the promo thing, the way I look at it is that if you're going to spend the time and the money on putting together a short version of the feature you're going to do.
You might as well shoot the feature, right?
Especially today. Now, keep in mind, when I made my movie, we shot on film, which, you know, today, you're not going to spend that money.
Mm-hmm.
And that, it's a fortune to make that. Mm-hmm. Today, you have a digital camera. I mean, you can shoot a movie on an iPhone.
Yeah.
You know, if you've got that good story. It, but it could be done.
I try to shoot myself.
Yeah. but, you know, so today it's a whole different world. You're not going to be spending that money on the film, the processing, the developing, the print, the dailies. All of a sudden, you're in for thousands of dollars, mm-hmm. where now you've got, you know, you got a Canon mm-hmm. camera for a few hundred bucks.
That's the truth. But you know what? Then there's this misconception that everybody picks up a camera is all of a sudden a director could shoot a film.
Oh, absolutely not.
And that's not the way it works.
Absolutely not, no.
You know, and you don't want to give anybody that conception.
No,
it's almost
not
like
at all.
The same conception as the actor that comes in. Everybody could be an actor. Well, not
right.
everybody could be a director.
No.
Is there more of a balance in when you're doing a film that that the script has to be great and the actors can just be okay? Or
what about
the actors are incredible and the script isn't? Does that ever work? It has to be. You have to hit the mark on all aspects of
the film. You do have to have a good script, okay? I mean, you have to have a good story. It's got to have all those elements in there. In terms of the actors, as a director,
because you could have a great script and great actors, and if you don't have the right angles and the camera capturing and the lighting, I mean, I go to see shows all the time and it drives me nuts because I'm in the business too, and
right.
I can, and especially plays that I watch, and I say if they just hit the light, if they get the angle here, if they move these people up, and I go crazy watching things
right.
because. You see, it's a great actor, but they're lost because they're not being shown properly in that shot.
Right. Well, you do need your good team, director, cinematographer, and the grips, and everyone, all those guys getting together to make that shot right. I mean, you have to have a good team together.
Mm-hmm.
I was very fortunate that I had a great team of people together that helped me achieve the vision that I had,
mm-hmm.
you know, and I would jump behind the camera. Peter Wheel was an amazing cinematographer, and we storyboarded everything.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, down to the shot, everything was storyboarded, the shot list, the whole nine yards. So we went into this whole thing knowing exactly what I wanted and how I wanted it to look. As a director, honestly, I would say that directing is 90% casting. 95% casting. If you've got the wrong cast, it ain't going to happen. It's just not going to happen. I don't want to sit there and try and get you to give me what I'm looking for. I want you to have it.
Right.
I want you to, like my father said, you get up in the morning, you scratch, you're done. That's it. I want you to be able to walk into that room and just be.
Be, yeah.
Okay, and I know we, adjust the lighting. No, get the camera over here. How's the sound? Okay, the technical stuff we'll take care of. Just go and do your deal.
Mm-hmm.
Tell me quickly.
Yes.
Tell us quickly. A little bit of the storyboard of Going Down.
Going Down. Going Down is a rough, tough downtown Brooklyn wise guy film about Paulie and Joey. Paulie is a bent out of shape wise guy drug addict. Joey lost his father recently. He's Paulie's younger cousin. So going through what he's going through, Paulie brings Joey into his group of friends. And Joey kind of becomes a man throughout the whole process. But he gets sucked into the life of Paulie, the side of Paulie he never knew. So now, he's all roped in. Does Joey make it right? Or is he going down with his cousin Paulie? That's what we got.
Okay.
It's a story that comes from the streets of Red Hook.
Is some of this you?
You know...
Tough question?
It's a tough question. So, I mean... You know, so it's not yes and no. I mean, some of it's stuff that I was involved with. I play the character of Paulie. I was not Paulie.
Okay.
Okay. Did I know a Paulie? Yes.
Okay.
Did I know a Joey? Yes. Was I a Joey? Maybe at one point. Was I kind of a Paulie at one point? Yeah, a little bit. Was I Minnick? Yeah. Was I Tony? Yeah. So there's a little bit of me in every one of the characters, because you live that life. Sometimes you walk the streets and you know these people, and you kind of put these stories together.
And you pull from it.
Yeah, exactly.
Okay.
So yeah, that's a hard one. I mean, you see the movie, you'll understand. No, that's not me.
Okay. Okay.
But there is real life experience, and you know, from that I drew on.
When we talked last week. You told us some fascinating stories of some of the actors, how they came about. And one that really tweaked me was Vinnie Vella.
Vinnie Vella.
And was it Scorsese's mother's restaurant or something?
No, it was...
was that?
I was the bar manager over at Zeppeli at Tribakery.
Okay.
At the time, and which I believe is long gone now. Anyway, we're doing a party for Martin Scorsese's mother's cookbook. It's a launching party for his cookbook. Catherine Scorsese.
Great lady.
Yes. And I'm behind the bar, and I'm just like, wow, everyone, you know, all these people here, and is that. And then Vinny Vella's at the bar with his buddy Jimmy Morricone. And I'm just keeping my mouth shut like I'm supposed to do, because, you know, you, that's what you do. You just serve the drinks, and that's it. Anyway, Vinny Vella's Vinny Vella, and we start talking, and I'm like, hey, Vinny, I'm making a movie. Yeah, oh, you're making a movie. Yeah, I am. You want to take a look at the script? I got a character that's perfect for you. You got one? I'm like, yeah, it's right here in my briefcase behind the bar. So I gave him a script, and he called me a couple days later, and he's like, okay, yeah. I said, really? He said, yeah. I'm like, all right, we'll do it then. And that's how that whole thing started.
So he wasn't necessarily an actor.
I'm sorry?
He wasn't an actor.
Oh, he was an actor.
Oh, he was an actor.
Oh, yeah.
Okay.
He was an actor.
Oh,
okay.
Yeah, he's awesome. He's a very funny guy.
Vinny Vella.
Hilarious.
I worked with Vinny Vella. I brought him later on, a bunch of years later. I called him up again to be in a short film I produced, Ursa Minor. He played the lead guy behind the, the softball bowling pin game at the carnival.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah, it was a great little film. A buddy of mine, David Joella, called me up. I was in a semi-retirement mode. We had just had, my wife and I, we just had twins.
Mm.
So 8 months into it, my buddy David called me up. He said, you got to come back. You got to make movies with me. You got to produce this film. And he sent me the script. And I had the co-director wanted me to shoot this in the San Gennaro Feast. No. You're out of your mind. That's what we can make it. We can create it. So we ended up creating a 2-block version of the feast.
Oh.
And we have Vinny Vella to play him. Hysterical.
Oh, he's a funny guy.
Oh, I love Vinny. Love him.
You're a funny guy.
But I digress. Where were we?
Well, I'm gonna progress.
Okay.
Not digress or egress or progress. We're gonna progress now, because also in the Garden State Film Festival.
Yes.
You have two music videos which you did.
Right.
One is by a dear friend of ours at NJ Discover, Linda Charney.
Mm-hmm.
We've done some things with Linda over the years.
Yeah.
A dear, dear friend. She has this wonderful song, which I've heard a number of times, called When
song.
I Sing.
Yes. Mm-hmm. Great.
So how did that music video come about?
I met Linda a bunch of years ago. I met Scott first. Me and Scott we're fellow alumni at Boston University.
Okay.
And we got hooked up, I want to say it was LinkedIn or something like that. And we were talking, and I met Linda. I was producing a commercial for No Joe's over in Red Bank. So I grabbed Linda, and she was in the commercial, and we had a lot of fun with that. And then a couple years later, I bumped into Linda outside of Dive over in Seabright.
Okay.
And this was right after she had been nominated for the Grammy.
For the Grammy.
And we were talking, and got a phone call a couple days later, and she said, you know, both her and Scott, you know, we'd like to, you know, talk to you and get this next music video done. It's for When I Sing. It's not released yet. And so we sat and we talked, and I listened to the song for, probably 3-4 days first. Came up with a storyline. I interpreted the whole thing and drew some storyboard stuff out, and we sat on their back porch, and we discussed it. We talked about the whole thing, and I said, it's gonna be different from what you're used to doing. I mean, I'm going a whole different direction. I wanted to go real raw and true to form, no kind of funky stuff, and just, you know, tell a story.
So that's entered into the Garden State Film Festival.
Right.
And then you have another one.
Yes.
Is it Afterlife?
Yes, Afterlife for a new young artist, Cameron James. This is a special one. I had the itch to jump behind the camera this time. So I actually I shot this one myself.
Okay.
Which I'm very happy with. I'm very proud of this whole thing. But this is a funny one because Cameron, I shot another video for him years ago, Lovers in London, which premiered last year at the festival. And he didn't have a song yet. He just had an idea. So we had breakfast one day. He gave me the idea. He says, do you think we could do this? I said, yeah, sure, why not? I don't know. went home. I spent about a month coming up with the script, figuring that whole thing out. He wrote a song. We came together, and the whole thing just seemed to work. And then we got hit by Sandy, which really messed everything up. Through between locations and casting, everything just – it just threw everything way out. But in the we got it together and you know, pushed forward with everything.
Yes. Mm-hmm. Well, because we're all Jersey strong.
Yeah, absolutely.
Mm-hmm. We truly are. We're a unique species here in Jersey. Truly.
We got quite a mix. I think.
So you got a film and two videos at the festival?
Yes.
And you're running the concession stand, I heard.
You know, I got that email this morning. And, you know,
So, all right, so people can come to the film festival to see all of the work that you're doing. Is there anywhere else, websites or anywhere that they could see trailers or something?
Yeah, my website is www.redhookfilms.com. I'm also on Facebook, I'm on Twitter, or Red Hook Films.
Okay. Great. And Garry?
Facebook. Distressed.
Garry,
Distressed.
Okay.
Yeah, my fan page website is Garry Pastore at Facebook, and then www.distressedfilms.com. Distressedfilm.com. I'm sorry. www.destressedfilm.com.
Don't get stressed. Okay.
They can't get stressed saying it.
The folks can see the trailer links. Yeah, I see that. My favorite, you know, this is one of my favorite segments when you hold up your this is Richard Nixon getting on the helicopter.
I can do that. Yeah. My fellow Americans.
I am not a fuck.
There we go. So, if they go to our website, I have both your films linked to
Fantastic.
The trailers. See, I take care of you.
Wow, that's cool.
I do.
So everybody...
You're all right, Cal.
Well, I try.
He's a good guy, that guy.
He's a good guy.
So we got the website, njdiscover.com, www.njdiscover.com. You can go there to see...
The article I wrote on both.
Articles and the links, and you'll be able to see the radio. We're actually on YouTube right now, are we not? We are...
Yeah.
Live, and
so
if you're not listening, you can watch us again, which is exciting. And you can go to Facebook, NJ Discover production page. You can learn about all the things that we're working on. And then we have an NJ Discover Facebook page for friends, and you can just see lots of crazy things that we're working on, too. So definitely connect with us and listen to the show again if you want, or watch the show.
Right.
And if you can, come to the Garden State Film Festival.
Because we'll be there, too, hanging out with you guys.
Mm-hmm. Oh, indeed. We're going to party.
Oh, we're going to party.
Yeah,
great. I love partying. I love that behind-the-scenes stuff.
Yeah, Land Shark.
Grappa and the Land Shark? This is great.
Okay, well, thank you, everybody, for tuning in. You want to thank anyone quick?
Yeah, I'd like to thank, first, for going down my cast and crew and all the investors, all the guys that came in. They really backed me and made something like this happen. They did it with a lot of faith.
Okay, any quick thanks?
I got to thank everybody that was involved in Distressed again. My my partner, Deborah Mello, my cinematographer and producer partner, Folke Barson, Patrick and Kasia Wazowski from Europe that invested in the film. My lovely publicist, Brigitte Lutz. And this great cast and crew that I got to work with.
Great. Well, thank you so much for coming.
Thank you.
And thank you guys.
Yeah, thank you.
Well,
guys.
Yeah, no, this was fun. This was sumptuous.
Yes, Calvin, those words tonight. I love it. Sumptuous.
Yeah,
speaking of sumptuous, my stomach is rumbling.
Hello, sumptuous.
All is well. Happy back. Monday.
Oh, that's it.
He told you 2 minutes, 5 minutes, 7 minutes ago.